Well, one last Super Bowl note for you. 42-year-old NFL Hall of Famer Warren Sapp was arrested this morning for soliciting a prostitute in Phoenix. He was there covering the Super Bowl for the NFL Network. The two women told police they were at the hotel as escorts. Now, Sapp admitted involvement in prostitution after he was caught with them during a fight over money. NFL Network fired Sapp just hours after the news broke.
The National Football League has spent an entire season dealing with plenty more than just the game. Social issues have become something of a political noose around their necks as they seek to keep the cash flowing while also proving to people they really care about those people with all the dollars. The Super Bowl proved they are concerned and maybe at the same time still focused on all the money. Welcome back to Midpoint. Having survived his time in the Arizona desert and not running afoul of Sheriff Joe Arpaio, the original sports business commentator, the sports professor, Rick Haro, joins us on the show. Good to see you again, Professor.
What kind of intro was that?
It was absolutely what you deserve and what you have earned and what is perfect for your stature in society, and you know it. Don't dare question
it. Wait, before you start,
yes.
5 days in the desert, I just gave a speech last night to a bunch of sports entrepreneurs here at Stanford University, and considering what I met and was exposed to in Arizona, that is absolutely two ends of the spectrum, my friend.
I'm going to have you need to write that down one of these days. That's a chapter in a book right there to talk about. But we shall eschew that for the moment and move away to some of the more interesting things. The National Football League, higher ratings, highest rated program ever, most watched by people in the history of television, hand over fist making money. Rick, let's face it. This has been a tough year. Domestic abuse, sexual abuse, videos, alcoholism, drug use, players basically showing absolutely no respect for the referees, the officials, anybody whatsoever. All of these social issues the NFL wants us to believe that they care about. Yet at the end of the day, people say, I'm not going to watch the game. I'm not going to go there. I'm tired of the NFL with all of these different issues. People still show up in droves, Rick. It doesn't make a difference. The NFL could say nothing and people would still show up in record amounts of crowds and money. Right?
Is that a question?
There it is. I said right at the end to throw it at you. Go ahead.
Yeah, listen, the bottom line is, as usual with us, and I mean this with all due respect, it's not that simple. And if you put it in an Alcoholics Anonymous perspective, which I know is hard to do, when you hit rock bottom and people notice an issue, then they respond to it. Everybody understands the 120 million people watching, the 3 million required user space that NBC had on their internet access, and on, sponsors, 4.5 million for 30-second spots, 45,000 in 1967 with the first Super Bowl. We all have our pet numbers, including, by the way, 35% increase in antacid purchases the Monday after the Super Bowl. Bet you didn't know that. But here's the bottom line of all of this. The NFL understands the juggernaut and what it means. And every owner that I talk to at the Super Bowl realizes how the processes that needed to be in place were put in place. Now, that doesn't mean it exonerates the NFL from guilt, clearly. But the domestic abuse policy was promised by Roger Goodell before the Super Bowl, and it was put in place in mid-December. And major sponsors appear to understand that the NFL is attempting a meaningful process to move forward with that. That doesn't excuse the Warren Sapps and the other behavior like the rest of the society. But understanding that Roger Goodell will continue to go back to his enforcer role, and hopefully the union goes along as well.
You talk to the NFL owners, though. Do they really care at the end of the day about whether or not this game is socially relevant when they are counting the money?
Well, yes, and let me tell you why. There are a good deal of owners, and you may not believe this, but I know of very many who really do care about the NFL as a role model and sending the appropriate signal and doing the right thing. Then there are other owners, candidly, who understand that if they don't do the right thing and don't send the right signal, the dollar signs aren't as prolific as they were before. So whether it's out of social caring or utilitarianism, they get to the same place.
They get to the same place, and it still comes down to money and ratings. Okay, speaking of ratings and numbers, let's go to money, if you will. Jimbo Fisher, the head coach at Florida State, $44 million potential for his contract. Rick, this just points out to people again, a head coach getting paid $44 million to coach a football team. That still shows again how out of whack to a lot of people the priorities are at colleges.
Now, out of whack to a lot of people, you wrote my notes this morning as we discussed this, and I don't know if it was a typo, but you said Bimbo instead of Jimbo. So I don't know if that's your position or not, but I will tell you this, that when you put it in the context of Florida State making $140 million in their football program on the revenue side. Michigan paying outrageous numbers to Jim Harbaugh. We all understand that. But their revenue on the football side is going to approach $150 million. Nick Saban, the same kind of number. Kevin Sumlin, Texas A&M, same kind of number. Max Strong at Texas, same number. When you're at the $140, $150 million number and you're paying $7 million and you look at the context of a CEO or COO with stock options in a public company producing those same kind of revenues, it's not so out of whack. Now, you can't say that to the director or head of a chemistry department or an English department at a university, but they'll never be convinced. Everybody produces revenue, but look at it, as we all do now, as a business, and you understand.
I wanted to get your take here on the Chris Christie gate, if you will, at least what they're calling it around the NFL. The fact that he's a Dallas Cowboy fan, he's the governor of New Jersey. Isn't it fair to say that in this day and age, fans are so zealous in their love for a team? If you're a politician now, more than ever before, you've got to be very careful the team that you identify with, because it can and will come back to snap at you if you attempt to run for a high office.
Well, it snaps at you if you hug Jerry Jones and you are in New Jersey and the Giants and Jets are there, the dreaded rival, the Giants and the Cowboys. But, you know, you're a football fan, and Christie has made a political decision that most people leave that issue at the ballot box. He might be right. He might be wrong. John McCain, by the way, said before the game here when I was in Arizona, he said, look, I hate the Seahawks and I hate the Patriots because they beat my beloved Cardinals, so I don't care if either one wins. So I guess there is an issue about making sure that you stay as a fan. Now, if there's question about using public money to travel or taking time off to travel, that's an entirely different issue, but I don't think we're there.
I only got about 20 seconds left. Would you agree that there was absolutely no conspiracy whatsoever? Oliver Stone was not there at the Super Bowl. This wasn't something that came out of the heavens here the last couple seconds of the game?
No. Although you got to say it was one of the best games you ever possibly saw.
Thank you.
I think the conspiracy got dropped down, and he put that ball in Kurse's hands at the 3-yard line to get to that point. No conspiracy. Take that to the bank. Newsflash.
Thank you so much. I'm so glad you said that. For once, you and I actually agree on something.
We agree on this narrow issue. Don't get used to it.
Trust me, I never do. I've been doing it for over 25 years. I've never gotten used to it. The professor, the sports professor, Rick Harrow, have a great time in California, my friend. We'll talk to you again next week.
All right, see you next week, man.
All right, take care. Away from the worldwide crises that are going on right now, there is one country that at the moment is turning Europe and world economies on their ear. Another bailout and more when Midpoint continues.